Yeah, hello. Yeah. So let me just start by clarifying this thing that we discussed yesterday, but I don't want to go too much into details about this because we may get delayed about the rest of the lecture. But I have written a couple of explanation notes also, which I'm going to share. And this should be clear. So basically, let me just say that, you know, there was a situation where we ended up with this equation. So this equation was a no bar no Markov equation, okay? And what I said is that you have to substitute this, so to say, Born Markov approximation into this Born approximation into this no Markov, and then you will end up getting a Born approximated equation for rho tilde dot. Okay, so I've given an ex so the question was, there was some confusion about why this R naught. So I've given some explanations here. So let me just you know, briefly tell you how one way of thinking about how it goes. So let's say that you start with an assumption that a chi tilde basically at any time t decouples into rho of t and r of t, okay, and plus some corrections. And now if you act it on both sides by this e to the ist and e to the minus ist, you just act it on this, so to say, ansatz, okay, then you will see that what happens is that after some algebra, you will actually get something like this. Okay, you'll actually get something like this. Which is chi tilde t is nothing but rho tilde t times this piece here. Okay. But then this r of t is in the Schrödinger picture and it has its own dynamics. And then what happens is that if you write this r of t back in terms of r of 0, then it has an additional e to the minus ihrt. And basically these things actually cancel out and you actually end up getting this equation here. Okay, which is what we wrote in the previous lecture. So I'll anyway share this on the website and you can read about it. It's written in words. But basically, the important point is that you can think of Born approximation as this statement here, and where you have chi tilde t, which is the total density matrix in the interaction picture, is rho tilde t, which is the system density matrix in the interaction picture, times R naught, plus some order HSR corrections. Which you anyway don't care because keep in mind that we already have two HSRs here. So it's important to note that we already have two HSRs, right? So we have HSR commutator of a commutator. So we don't want any more system bath coupling. Those are anyway higher order. Okay, so we don't really care about that. Okay, so that is basically some clarification. And I have made some additional comments here about the Born Markov approximation. So I will leave it as it is. And we will, so there are many, many statements I have made here, which you can read and we can discuss once you, if there are any other questions. Okay. So the broad idea is that the system gets affected by the reservoirs, but the reservoir, you know, in some sense, basically just has its own dynamics. Okay, so there is this, but as a result of reservoirs dynamics and reservoirs coupling to the system gets impacted. And we are interested to write sort of a alone equation for the system by integrating out the reservoirs. Okay. Anyway, I will discuss the quantum harmonic oscillator, and these things will become more explicit here. Okay. Okay, so here we basically yesterday already I introduced some form of HSR. So remember, HSR is basically this coupling between the system and the bath. Okay, so I just, you know, denote it like this. It's something made of some system operator, something made of bath operator. Okay. Then if you take this literally this definition. And you can again go to its interaction picture. So remember that interaction picture just amounts to acting these things on either side. And you know, you can write it as, it turns out that Si gamma I will become Si tilde gamma I tilde. Okay, now what is Si and what is gamma I? for specific situations, we will discuss in like few minutes. Okay. But if I take this form, okay, and plug it into, you know, the Born Markov equation, okay, plug it into the Born Markov equation, which is equation 11 of lecture one. So let me actually show you equation 11 of lecture one, which is this equation. Okay, I'm just substituting HSR. Okay, that gamma I, SI gamma I, I'm just substituting that. Okay. So I'm just substituting that, and if I substitute that, I will just get equation two here. Okay. So notice that basically let us focus on just one of these terms. Let's forget this additional term plus. Okay, let's focus on just one term. So that will be just this term multiplied by this term. Okay. Notice that this average value here basically stands for tracing over reservoirs. Okay. And SI is part of system, and rho tilde is the reduced density matrix of the system. Okay. So basically, you know, this is just, you know, rewriting rho tilde more explicitly. Okay. Now, as I said, that we can justify replace. So here, this is just still no Markov. Okay. This is non Markov still. Okay. Because if you notice, I have T primes here. Okay, I have T primes. Okay, so and here I write that we can justify the replacement rho tilde of T prime by rho tilde of T if correlations decay very rapidly on the system time scales. Okay, and of course, ideal situation would be if this gamma gamma correlation is delta function. Okay, So the Markov approximation, as mentioned previously, relies on two widely separated timescales, a slow timescale for the dynamics of the system and a fast timescale characterizing the decay of correlation functions of the reservoir. Okay, so a more clear understanding can be achieved when we go to our first example, which is damped harmonic oscillator. Okay, so just to keep in mind, this gamma gamma correlator, this gamma is what? This gamma is just bunch of reservoir operators, and it also has information of the system reservoir coupling. Okay, you will see exactly what this gamma is for the harmonic oscillator. Okay, so now till now I have given some shape to HSR. I have said it is SI gamma I, but now let us become even more explicit. Okay, let us become even more explicit as to what is gamma and what is S. Okay.
Janos,
yes. Yeah.
Before you go, this like for what you have said so far, is it this form important, or it can be some function of SI times some function of gamma I, sum over I, and then is it that this gamma I gamma j correlation becomes functions of gamma I, yeah, gamma j? Is it true?
So at this moment, you know, let me just write like
some g of
gamma I, right?
You mean? Yeah,
right?
Yeah.
At this moment, you can still do this. Yes, absolutely. Okay. But what happens is that then when you want to calculate the bath correlations, then it becomes a little more complicated, because you will you can still, this is still general.
So then in the final form, it will be, instead of this correlation function between gamma I gamma j, it will be like this z of gamma I gamma j interaction picture.
Yes.
Is it correct?
That is correct. And in fact, I'll not be teaching in this lecture notes, but there are situations where literally there are interactions of the form A dagger BK BK dagger BK, you know, something like that, where plus Hermitian conjugate. So thing is that you can have two operators of the bath also.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. So now let us come to some specific concrete model, and really sort of understand what we mean by open harmonic oscillator. Okay, so the microscopic model for a damped harmonic oscillator is given by this piece here. Okay, so this is so let me just write a couple of things. So this is single mode harmonic oscillator. Okay, and this is basically system of interest. Okay, this is literally A dagger A is my harmonic oscillator. Okay, so now what is, so this A dagger A, you can think of this harmonic oscillator as if, you know, one way to realize it is by some very good cavity mirrors and so on. But there's a single mode harmonic oscillator. Now, what is a bath? Okay, so this is bath, okay, which is made of many harmonic oscillators. Okay, this bath is made of many harmonic oscillators. Why? Because you have J here. Okay, so the bath is basically the system is just a single harmonic oscillator, but the bath is, you know, if you want, you can take infinite number of harmonic oscillators. Okay. And what is the system bath coupling? Okay, the system bath coupling is very simple. So it is basically one operator from the system and one operator from the bath. Okay. And it's Hermitian conjugate. Okay, you can ignore this. We will make connection to SI gamma I later. Okay, so I hope this is clear. So what is our system and bath? I hope it is clear. So, and these kappas are basically the coupling between system and the bath, but there is an index J because it may couple differently. The system may couple differently to different modes of the bath. Okay, different. If you want labels of the bath.
Aman, can I add a point here?
Sorry.
Can I add a point here?
Sure.
Yeah. So you said this number of bath oscillators can be infinite. So is that? Is that correct? Like, should we actually say that? I mean, because if the bath oscillators are infinite, then there should be a problem with the Poincaré recurrence time, right? Some n oscillators, right? So that, you know, we have some limitations on this recurrence time.
So here is the thing. So suppose I have n oscillators. Let's say I have one cavity, one mode for the system, and say some 500 oscillators, right? So then they will, then eventually, if you do the exact dynamics of all these things, you will have some recurrence. Right. But here, what I want to do is I want to effectively integrate out the system in this, or integrate out the bath. Okay. So my effective non-Hermitian system, okay, is not going to have any more recurrence.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So, but actually I will, in the next lecture, I'll actually say a few things about recurrence by considering bath as a large, but finite number of, Okay. Yeah.
That's fine.
Okay, so now I hope this is, so if this is not clear, please ask me, because things will get more detailed now. So the system is a harmonic, system S is a harmonic oscillator with frequency omega, this should have been omega C, with frequency omega C, and the reservoir is modeled as a collection of harmonic oscillators with frequency omega J, okay, and so on. And the oscillator couples to the jth reservoir via coupling kappa j. Okay. So these are just some notes, but as emphasized before, the total Hamiltonian is still Hermitian, right? The total Hamiltonian is of course still Hermitian, and what we have to do is we have to find some effective equations of motion for rho dot, where this is just for the cavity mode, if you want. Okay. So that's the plan. Okay. So now let us go a little bit more specific and see. In general, we don't need to be so specific, but let us take the reservoirs to be in a thermal equilibrium at temperature T. Okay, so the reservoir is basically, the reservoir density operator is basically given like this. Okay, so I would encourage everyone to actually show this, Okay, so this is nothing but, you know, you can just write it as e to the minus beta hr by z. Okay, so you just basically literally calculate the density operator, and please do this, and if you have any doubts of how to get this, then I can explain it. Okay, so this is something that that I encourage everyone to do. Okay, so let me just write. So where z, so z is nothing but trace of e to the minus beta hr. Okay, so and you can, for trace you can choose convenient Fox space representation, and it is a very easy exercise. Okay, but good thing is you know this, you know this explicitly. Okay, so notice that it's useful to have this explicit thing, because this, we know that this is entering those integrals that I discussed before. And you see some important things like temperature, omega j, okay, these things are sort of showing up explicitly. Then we can ask the question, what happens to those correlation functions, how do they decay, and so on. Okay, so that is the reason why I explicitly chose R naught. But I just wanted to say that you don't need to be so specific. Okay. Okay, so I will not repeat these things. So these are some things that I just sort of you know, motivated. You can have these kind of reservoirs can either be from due to leakiness in cavities, and in principle, as far as the reservoir is concerned, you can even the reservoir itself is a pretty good reservoir to even study atoms coupled to environments. Okay, when we have a two level system coupled to environment, we are actually going to use the same kind of reservoir. Okay, so as far as reservoirs is concerned, the bunch of harmonic oscillators serves as a good reservoir.
This A and R, they commute with each other.
Which one? A and R.
A and R.
Yes. Absolutely. So A is just for the system, and R is for all the environments. In fact, RJ and RJ prime also commutes. Okay.
Okay.
So because R can be R1, R2, R3 up to say R500, and the okay. These are just bunch of independent harmonic oscillators. Okay, so is that clear? That's Sanjeev.
Yes.
Okay. Also, you see, these kind of reservoirs are also quite important, because they represent like phonon modes in a solid. Okay, so if you have like condensed matter systems and you have these phonon substrates, it's important, because these substrates actually, you know, effectively start behaving like bunch of harmonic oscillators, and to mimic the role of phonon modes, you actually need to incorporate them systematically. Okay, so now coming back to our general notation. So our general notation was Si gamma I. Okay, so now we will become very clear about what is S and what is gamma. So now let me expand this a bit. So let me just write it as h bar S1 gamma 1 plus S2 gamma 2. Okay, notice that if I make this identification that S1 is A, okay, S2 is A dagger, gamma 1 is here, okay, and gamma 2 similarly here, then we basically have our Hamiltonian. Okay, so now what is, so S1, okay, so S1 is A and S2 is A dagger, that is fine, right? So now gamma 1 is nothing but summation j kj star rj dagger. Okay, so gamma 1 is, I told you gamma 1 is when I told you gamma 1 is gamma 1 is some operator in the bath. Okay, so the question is, what was it, right? So in this particular case, gamma 1 is actually this sum. Okay, so coming to Sanjeev's point, this gamma 1 is already a pretty complicated function of the bare fundamental operators of the bath. Okay, so the gamma 1 can, it just has to represent some operators in the reservoir, okay? But they don't need to be literally the fundamental operators, okay? They can be some linear combinations or whatever, depending on our situation, okay? So I hope everyone is clear that gamma one, which is basically sort of, I would say, we will call it reservoir, but keep in mind that it is little bit more than a reservoir because it also has this kappa j in it. Okay, it also has this kappa j in it. So it's a linear combination of reservoir operators with information of kappa j. Okay, and what kappa j does, kappa j decides which j I should couple to my a with what strength, right? So kappa j couples, reservoir to system, but it will decide which j I will couple in what strength, okay? Okay, so this is basically this thing. Now I hope this is clear. Please let me know if there are any questions at this point, because now it's basically just algebra. You basically substitute these things into my previous equation, right? Just substitute this thing into this equation, right? Into this equation, I'm literally going to substitute whatever I wrote for SI and whatever I wrote for gamma I. Okay, so and in doing so, we actually get this equation 6. Okay, we get equation six. Okay, so now let us sort of be a little bit slow here. So what have we done, right? So basically, remember that the previous equation had S tildes. Okay. So let me just actually add a page and do this just sketch this calculation. So this is a lengthy calculation, but just to get an idea. So remember that we had somewhere S1 tilde, right? We had S1 tilde in our previous expression, but what is S1 tilde of T? S1 tilde of T, by definition, because of this, okay, because of this definition, is nothing but A tilde of T. Okay, but what is A tilde of T? A tilde of T is nothing but e to the power I omega cavity A dagger A T, A e to the minus I omega cavity A dagger A T. Okay, so this is nothing but, I mean, e to the I H S T A e to the minus I H S T. Okay, now this one, with a little bit of effort, you can show that this actually is quite simple. It just becomes e to the minus I omega cavity T. Okay. Okay. So wherever I see S1 tilde, I actually directly substitute this. Okay. I directly substitute this. Okay. Are you able to see my screen? This thing that I'm writing here. Yeah. So I directly substitute this. And one way of just doing it, so this is easy. You just use Baker-Hausdorff lemma, okay? And you can just, so you'll have to do a lot of calculations like this, okay? Like of this type, okay? To get what I have shown there, okay? Okay, so just going back, so I hope. So you see, that is why what we have ended up is, we have ended up with just A's, okay? We have just ended up with A's, okay? Because of this, and explicit time dependence has come here. Okay, the rest of the thing I have left as tilde. The rest of the thing I'm still left as tilde, and gamma also I have left as tilde. Okay. Okay, so basically, now we have to deal with these things. Okay, now we have to deal with these things. Now you have to do similar things there also. Okay, similar things like gamma I, gamma one tilde, you have to do something like IHRT gamma one e to the minus IHRT. Okay, and then you can explicitly calculate these, and then you can plug it back. Okay. So after equation six, what you will get is, so in equation six, we have written these terms here. Okay, we have written these terms here, and these terms are nothing but here explicitly calculated. Okay. Okay. You should be able to show this. So forget about the extreme right hand side, but you should be able to show this. So what you do is, how do you do this? You take the definition of gamma, then go to gamma tilde. Okay, the gamma tilde will have r tilde. From r tilde, you can get back r, and then you will actually have these extra time dependences. Okay, so is there any questions at this stage?
So calculating this expectation, R naught is assumed to be the thermal state, right?
Sorry.
The R naught is assumed to be the thermal state, right?
Yes. So I'll come to that. Maybe I will just sketch one small thing, which I think might be useful to just do this calculation. Okay, so maybe I'll just anyway sketch it in case it may be useful for. So what I'm trying to say is that imagine you want gamma 1 tilde t. Okay, so what is gamma 1 tilde t? So gamma 1 tilde t is e to the I h r t gamma 1 e to the minus I h r t. Okay, so now this is nothing but e to the I summation omega j rj dagger rj t. This gamma itself is summation j kappa j star rj, and then e to the minus I summation omega j rj dagger rj. So you can say J prime or something. Okay, so let me there's some notations here. So let me call this let me call this n actually. N and minus I summation m omega m r m dagger r m t. Okay, and what you should be able to show is that this is nothing but summation over j kappa j star r j e to the r j e to the minus I omega j t, something like this. Okay, so what I'm trying to say is that you can explicitly write gamma tilde in terms of just bare rj. Okay, you can just explicitly write gamma tilde in terms of rj and then substitute it back into that equation. Okay, so then if you do that, then basically you end up getting these values. So notice now we have four of these. Okay, we have four of these, 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, and notice that two of them actually turn out to be zero because this is zero. Okay, this is zero. Okay, so I hope it's very easy to show that this is zero. So the way you do it is you just use some convenient basis such as some Fock state basis, and you basically evaluate this trace explicitly, and you will see that this is actually zero. The only thing that doesn't go to zero is this piece and this piece. Okay, so I can literally forget about these terms in the equation. Okay, so what survives is this one. Okay, so what happens is that this piece here precisely is just this piece. Okay, where this piece is given here. Okay. So I hope it's very clear in my notes. So even if you don't follow the details at this moment, it is okay. But the point is that important thing to note is that you have to explicitly calculate this and this, and that is anyway given here, which is very easy. This is just this, and this is just this. Okay. So this is again an easy calculation. Okay. You just substitute. So here I'm going to use the R naught that I defined above. Okay. And I'm going to explicitly calculate the trace, and you can show that this is nothing but this. So this is the Bose function, and it has information of temperature and the frequency. Okay, so you notice that. So what have we done so far, right? So far we have in some sense tremendously simplified our gamma correlation.
So Manas, essentially this is the force correlation, right? Like in our XP, like first quantization picture, we have this force correlation, random force correlation, right? So this is what exactly it is.
So what I would say is that this gamma, as I said, is some linear combination of reservoir operators, right?
Correct. Yeah. So, yeah, exactly. So that random force correlation was also like that, linear combination of bath operators,
right?
And some system parameters in it.
Some system parameters. Yeah,
so,
exactly.
So, I mean this.
Right.
Yeah. Right. And this function, this exponent of something that leads to a cotangent hyperbolic, right?
Yes. So I'll come to those. I'll come. So at this moment, you see, at this moment, I'm still leaving it in the summation. Okay. I'll come to that. So let me just circle the thing that we have to investigate, right? So let us pick up one thing here. So let me just box the thing that we have to further investigate, right? Okay. This is the thing, right? So where does this go? Okay. Where does this go? This goes to this equation. So let us remember the flow. Okay, so this goes to this equation here. Okay, this goes to this equation. Now, once I investigate that, then I can say, then I can ask the question: can I make rho tilde t prime to rho tilde t, right? So please note that there is only Born approximation here, no Markov approximation yet. Okay, so I'm investigating this, explicitly trying to calculate as much as I can, and then saying that, okay, is it really fast decaying? In what conditions it is fast decaying? And then I will do my Markov approximation, and then I will, once I do the Markov approximation, this rho tilde t is going to simplify even further and further, and that's the story. Any other questions? Okay.
Manas.
Yes.
So for this harmonic oscillator, if I go beyond Born approximation, what would be the second order term look like? In this, it'll be something more than this gamma correlation, right?
Yes. So one thing is that it'll actually be presumably what will happen is four operators of the bath will be involved, And the interesting thing is, notice that in principle, so it will be okay. This is very rough way of this thing, but presumably, you know, it will, let's say, RJ prime. So let's say RJ 1, RJ 2, RJ 3, RJ 4, or something.
Okay.
It will have this four, but that's okay because really you can compute these things for quadratic problems.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. So that is very important thing. So that is important. So you can again use Wick's theorem and compute this. So because the reservoir is simple. Okay. The reservoir is simple. So that piece you can still handle. Mm-hmm. But what happens is that the rest of the piece also becomes complicated, and it's a hard problem to go beyond Born approximation. Yeah.
Even for harmonic oscillator.
Right. Even for harmonic.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you directly say fourth order because the third order terms will be zero, like from this argument only. The correlation functions will be.
That's right. Exactly. Because you can literally calculate these traces, right? I would really encourage everyone, I mean, really, it's very important to calculate these kind of quantities, okay? use Fock state basis and explicitly calculate all these things, and then you will see which ones survive, which don't survive, and so on.
Can I add something here, Manas?
Sure.
So it turns out that for this harmonic oscillator models, people have derived exact master equations, both in the Markovian form and non-Markovian forms. Although rate matrices depend on the times. So, I mean, it is possible to derive exact equations. So without making Born and Markov approximations. I just wanted to say that.
Right, but I think the question was, if you want to go to next order, just the fourth order, then presumably if you go to the fourth order, the equations look quite complicated and it's still hard even for a single
harmonic oscillator. We cannot continue this program naively because when you the first step of your equation of motion, you sort of integrated and put it back in the Schrodinger equation, this one-dimensional equation, right? It becomes subtle that it comes rho of zero actually. When you do naive integration, one has to do more systematic program to compute.
Right. Of course, I think one point I wanted to make also related to Sanjeev's question is we are going to do this quantum harmonic oscillator with Born-Markov approximation and explicitly write down values of some quantities. And in the next lecture, what I'm going to do is I'm going to just present some results from quantum Langevin equation, which is non-perturbative in system bath coupling. And we'll actually try to make a comparison between both and see where they agree, where they disagree. So we are going to compare these, compare the things that I'm going to present today with some exact solutions tomorrow. Okay, but not from quantum master equation, but just from Langevin equation, present some quantities and just show how to go from Langevin to master equation in some limits. Yeah. Okay. So now let me.
Manas, one quick question.
Yeah.
Here you said T, rho of T and rho T prime to be equal. So that's equivalent to assuming that omega C doesn't.
Your voice is a bit low. Can you speak? Your voice is a bit low. Hello.
Am I audible now?
Yeah.
So when you said T to be, the rho at T to be same as rho at T prime. Is it equivalent to saying that there is no omega C that? Omega C does not resonate with any of the omega I minus omega J.
I'll come to this point. So at this moment, it's a question mark here. Okay. I'll come to that point once I do some more evaluations of this. Okay.
So far, you're not assuming anything about omega C relative to omega I.
So far, I'm not assuming anything. No.
Okay. Well, one more question. So at least for this particular model, this is still a quadratic bosonic model.
Right.
So you can exactly solve it. So do you know in what limit the Born-Markov approximation will be accurate or compared to the exact solution?
Right. So the point is. You can solve it exactly, let's say, using quantum Langevin equation, but to actually get some explicit solutions of some observables, you can get some steady state solutions exactly. And I will show that in the limit of weak system bath coupling of the steady state solutions of exact steady state solutions, we will recover the solutions of Born-Markov equation.
So
from exact methods, I'm going to tomorrow I'm going to just show some quantities, okay, some current or in some other current or occupation numbers, some exact forms. Then I will take that exact form and then make a weak system bath coupling of that exact form carefully, okay, and then I will show in what limit it goes to the expressions that I'm going to derive today. Okay. So this will become quite clear. So remember that whatever we get today out of this quantum harmonic oscillator is going to be in the Born Markov limit. But at this moment, I have not started the Markov yet. So now I will go to the Markov limit. So I'm at this moment, I'm just trying to analyze this piece. Okay, I'm just trying to analyze this piece. Okay. So now the correlation functions in equation 7 can be derived by evaluating the trace using multimode Fox test or the basis as a basis. So this is just exercise. Okay, all these are exercises. Okay. So now we have this. So question is, what do we do, right? So first we will change summation to an integration by introducing density of states, okay, g omega, such that g omega d omega gives the number of oscillators with frequency in the interval omega to d omega, omega to omega plus d omega. So in other words, this summation can be replaced by this integration, where g omega is the density of states of the reservoir. Okay. So this is nothing but just trying to simplify this a little bit further, and then we'll make some change of variables. We'll introduce a tau as t minus t prime, and the above equation, you know, the equation 6 can be just compactly written in as a form of equation in the form of equation 9. Okay. Where now these things are now written. So remember that we had already got rid of two of them, right? We had got rid of these two. Okay. So now we are left with slightly more simple looking. We just have two pieces, and both these two pieces are basically written in integral form. So here I hope that this is just summation to integral, and there is nothing much here. So this is still my reservoir correlation. Okay. Okay. So now where we should remember what n bar is, n bar omega t, I think it's there here. So this is just this, okay, which is this. So let me write it again somewhere. Ah, okay, it's written here. Okay, it's written in equation 11. Okay. So now we have equation. So let us stare at these equations for a minute. So we have equation 9. So what have we done in equation 9? In equation 9, we have got rid of all the reservoir correlations which are identically zero. We have only focused on the one which are non-zero. We have also gone from a summation to an integration by just introducing density of states. And we have just made a replacement of t prime to be of tau to be t minus t prime. Okay. So here, no more time dependence, right? Because we are now we have rewritten this a such that we had replaced a tilde by a. Okay, so now this A doesn't have any time dependence. Okay, so remember that, let me just recap. So recap that we had something like A tilde of T, which is that E to the IHST, A E to the minus IHST, but for our HS, this was just E to the minus I omega cavity T. Okay, and that is why this omega cavity here is now explicitly appearing. Okay. So as far as equation 9, 10, and 11 are concerned, is there any question? So let us, so this is the equation. This is still Born equation, no Markovian approximation yet, because we still have this thing. Okay. So the Markovian approximation will consist of replacing T minus tau by just T. Okay. Then that means then you have achieved Markovian approximation. Okay. So this combination G of omega kappa omega square. So now notice that what is kappa omega square? Kappa omega square is this continuum form of this kappa J, right? So this combination is called Bath spectral density. Okay. So this whole combination is called Bath spectral density J of omega. So the Bath spectral density contains information of contains information of the density of states of the bath and also the information of how the bath is coupled to the system. Okay. Okay, so now we now revisit the issue of Markovian approximation. Okay, in other words, one can ask if equation 10 can be approximated to a Dirac delta function. Okay. So imagine this quantity. Okay, if this quantity, let me call this quantity f of tau. Let's say it's a function of it will turn out to be only a function of tau. So imagine as a function of tau, this is zero, okay, and it just fastly decays. Okay, it just fastly decays. Okay, then you can convince yourself that here, if it fastly decays, I can hopefully replace this by just t. Okay, because this is like it's just multiplying this by tau, but it just is so fastly decaying that it will just pick up its value near tau going to zero. Okay, so that is basically, I can pull it out of the integral. Okay, so that is the goal. The goal is to analyze this and ask when is it decaying faster, when is it not decaying faster, and so on. Okay, so in equation 10, note that for large enough tau, the oscillating exponential functions will average out slowly, the slowly varying functions basically to zero. Okay, so from here you can see that, of course, for large enough tau, you can see that this d omega, this will just average out these slowly varying functions. If you assume that j omega, so let me just write it as j omega n bar omega. Okay. If this is smooth function, then for large enough tau, it will just average to zero. That we know, right? That we can see just from physically, we can see that at large enough tau, it will average to zero. But question is, how large is large, right? So how large is large? And that is what we are going to answer. So can we get an estimation for this width of these reservoir correlations? Okay. So now to do that, what we do is we take some very standard. So what they do typically is that they take some form of this J of omega. Okay, they take some form of J of omega. Okay, so here we have considered J of omega to be an ohmic bath. Okay, so we just choose J of omega to be omega, some C times omega. Okay, because if I don't choose anything, then I don't know what to do with this integral, right? I want to choose a J of omega such that I can do this integral, right? So I'm going to choose this to be J of omega to be C times omega, and I'm going to do this integral. Okay. And then what happens? So let me just do it. So then I will just get gamma, this is dagger, gamma t minus tau is equal to integral 0 to infinity e to the I omega tau c omega, okay, by e to the omega by t, okay, minus 1 d omega. Okay, so this is an example. Okay, so I hope everyone is clear with this. So this is an example. So now I can explicitly evaluate this. Okay, now I can explicitly evaluate this. And if you choose this example, it'll actually turn out that this is actually some special function. Okay, it is called the trigamma function. Okay, but the most important thing is this is a special function which decays. Okay. And there's a time scale which naturally comes out here, which is nothing but h bar by kBT. So this is the important thing. So this is a special function which basically decays, and I have plotted it here. And the decay time scale is basically tau over tau r, where tr is nothing but h bar by kBT. Okay, so naturally you get some reservoir time scale. Okay, and this reservoir time scale basically turns out to be 1 over temperature. So this is an example where you can see that if I have more temperature, my reservoir time scale is shorter, right? So here you can basically get a little bit of handle on things about what is decaying faster. So let's say this is for some temperature. If you have a slightly higher temperature, then it will decay even faster. Okay, so the way to do these problems is you actually have to pick a bath spectral function, evaluate some integrals, and try to see what is the effective reservoir time scale that appears. And it turns out often that you will just basically see that more the temperature, better the Markovianity of the reservoir.
So for any powers of C omega to the power n, actually that will be the time scale, right?
That's correct. So for any powers, you can show that you can do some analytical calculation.
Yeah. Yeah. Because you can, at least you can scale out this thing. And so yeah, if you just define omega by T and tau times T, right, then you can, yeah, okay.
Right. Absolutely. But, and also actually, I didn't want to do that, but of course you can study some limits of this integral and try to show that you can, instead of getting the special function, you can actually get some, basic functions and understand it a little bit more. But I think the important thing is the emergence of this TR. Okay.
Yeah,
that's
right.
So that is the thing. So now we actually know what is happening, right? Now we sort of have an idea that what is this gamma-gamma correlation. And now we have this TR, okay? Okay, so now, the question is, now we go back to this equation, right? So now we go back to this equation, okay? So now we know that this thing, okay, this thing basically goes as decays as TR, okay, which is basically 1 over temperature. Okay, in this case, okay. Okay, so now there's something that I did not this thing. So now the question is, okay, still can we now? So now let me compare these two. Let me compare this with this, okay? So now the thing is, if I can show that the time scales at which the system changes, okay, is much longer than TR, then I am ready to do Markovian approximation, okay? But so the point is that is what you have to think about. So of course, this TR here, you sort of literally can put some numbers, some temperature of the situation, some temperature of the particular experimental setup, and you can get TR and TS, which I call the system time scale. Also, one can get some estimate of how slow the system is. And if you're sure that TS is far, far greater than TR, then you are ready to do Markov approximation. Okay, so this is the important thing I wanted to say. So I've written some sentences here. So the reservoir correlations are integrated against two time dependent terms. Okay, remember there are two time dependent terms here. One is this, and another is this oscillating term. Okay, so there are two time dependent terms. So we have situations when the system time scales is far greater than reservoir time scales. Okay, so here I didn't want to give numbers because you can actually some typical experiment numbers you can see, and they are almost orders of magnitude higher sometimes. Okay, so this is satisfied, which can justify the Markovian approximation replacement of this. Okay, then also integrating the reservoir correlation functions against this oscillating piece, we'll just extract their omega naught component, which is just like a Fourier transform. Okay, so these are just words, but basically what is happening is that you have done the Markovian approximation and pulled out this rho tilde, and the rest of that you just rest of the integral you just do it, and it will just amount to picking up the value of the integrand at omega naught. Okay, so the rest of it starts acting like a Fourier transform.
So Manas, we are like ensuring the stationarity here, right?
Sorry.
So we're ensuring the stationarity right here.
Stationarity of what?
Like you approximated like rho tilde t minus tau to a t, right? Rho tilde t.
Yes.
So this stationarity is assumed, right?
No. But rho tilde still depends on t. So rho tilde dynamics is still going to be there. It is just going to be pulled out of the integral. That's all.
Okay.
So the rho tilde is going to have some interesting dynamics, and this whole method actually gets the time dynamics of the system.
Okay.
So that is the thing. Yeah. Which is very hard to extract for example, for quantum Langevin equations to get the time dynamics. So okay. So I'll come to that next class. But okay. So now I hope that there are a lot of sentences written in these notes. So please read it, and I think it will become more clear. Okay. So if you put all these ingredients and simplify this equation, nine, okay. So you pull this out, of the integral, and so on and so forth, and simplify this equation 9, you will actually get equation 13. Okay, where essentially you can imagine that because I have pulled out the rows and things like that, I will just have this alpha and beta piece, which is given by this equation.
Sir, the trigamma function, the thing that you said about that key, the correlation function turns out to be of that form. So that's valid at all the temperatures, right? I mean, there is no difference in functional form at different temperatures.
Sure.
It's just that Markov approximation is good at high temperatures because of the time scale separation. But that calculation is valid for all temperatures.
Yes. Yeah, this is exactly. In fact, that is why it's a slightly complicated special function. If you do some temperature approximations, probably if you do some high temperature approximation, etc., you can reduce the special function to some other basic function. That's what I was trying to say.
So that special function probably has exponential tail, right?
This special function.
Trigamma function for large tau probably has an exponential tail. No?
Trigamma function. Right. I think
it is power law.
I think it should be power law actually. Yeah, it is power law tail.
But if it is a power law, then how do you define a one time scale temperature?
Because what you will get is in some limit you will actually get some Lorentzian. That width of the Lorentzian will basically play is going to come from TR.
So then if it is a power no okay so if it is power law, then is it good to say that this is the time scale beyond which it is because usually when you say that this is sharply peak, you mean exponential or some fast decaying function, right?
That's right. I think it is still okay, but if you really want to be more careful, typically what people do is sometimes instead of doing j omega c omega, you can introduce something like this.
Okay. But then you already put a cutoff by this one, I guess, right? That introduce another time scale. No?
Another time scale. Yeah. But I think so that should also be but that will introduce another time scale, but it should really matter, I think. Yeah.
Hi, Manas.
Hello.
So what governs the system time scales here?
So that's a good question. So now the question is, how do we know what the system time scale is, right? So the thing is, typically the way these things should be thought of is that you actually do this Von Markov approximation, and then you do some dynamics, okay, of the system. Then from there you will get some system time scale, okay, and then you should ask yourself whether that system time scale was indeed slow compared to the reservoir time scale. Okay, so sometimes what governs the system dynamics time scale is probably some kappa, some leakiness in the cavity. Okay, for example, that may govern how the system evolves in time. Okay, so but the way you should do it is you first do the Born Markov approximation, write down the equation for reduced density matrix, do the dynamics of the system, from there try to read out that system time scale, and then self consistently check whether that was indeed slow compared to the reservoir time scales. Okay. So sometimes what people do is from experiments they get an idea of the system time scale, and then they get a notion of how orders of magnitude larger it is compared to the Bath time scales. Okay, is that clear?
Yeah. Hello. Okay.
Yeah.
So I have a question. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
I have a question regarding how do you, in the experiments, how do you get this Bath timescale? Do you get this quantity of Bath correlation quantity?
So that is, you see, that is a bit hard. So typically, you know, for example, something that I wrote like this here. Okay, so you assume that by and large, many baths are effectively ohmic baths. And if I assume it's an ohmic bath, then I will end up getting this kind of time scale. Okay, and then you know the value of temperature of the setup, and then you will get some order estimate of the system reservoir time scale.
Okay.
So
there is no direct quantity which you measure. You assume this ohmic kind of.
Right. I think it's, you know, because you are actually doing measurements on the system, right? This path is so basically I doubt if you can, you know, try to estimate that. I think you can get the system time scales, but bath time scales, you know, just by having some intuition about temperature and all, you can write some order of magnitude estimate you can make.
Okay.
Finally, what we need is an order of magnitude estimate. That's all, right?
Manas, there is a couple of questions in the chat box.
Okay. So, I see. So. Where does it start? It starts from Atiyab, right?
Atiyab.
Is there any particular reason to have coupling constant K in gammas instead of S? Well, actually, you know, you could have put it in S, but the point is, in the end, what you want is, you want to write an equation where there is everything here of the system, and the rest of the thing you just associated with bath and system bath interaction, because finally you just want to evaluate that and study its decay properties. So putting it into A and redefining A might not be very helpful, because it's better to just assign it to gammas and calculate those explicit correlation functions, because remember this gammas have something called J omega, which has both the system bath coupling and density of states. So typically you assign it, that's why you assign it to the gammas. Okay. So because otherwise then you have to again worry about this kappa, right? Again, if you put it back into this, if you assign it to the system, then what do you do with it? Then how do you go to the continuum limit, and that kappa of omega will still be hanging around. So it becomes a little difficult. Okay. So next question, one can derive Langevin like equations from starting Hamilton, right? Heisenberg equation motion. What is the difference? Okay. This is basically going to be in my next class. Okay. Next lecture, I'm going to talk about quantum Langevin. So I'll clarify everything there. Okay. Next question is, the expectation value of cohesion functions appear to depend on average occupation number n, which seems to follow Boltzmann. Is this always the way we can do? No, so the point is, if we had set up the whole problem in terms of fermions, let's say you have a quantum dot coupled to some fermionic reservoir, then you end up getting Fermi Dirac distribution. But since it's a problem on bosons, then you will end up getting Bose distribution. So notice that this is the Bose distribution because I'm not taking any high temperature limit. Just maybe the way I wrote it is a bit. So where was it? So notice that this is the Bose distribution here, which I just rewrote like this. Okay. So of course, if you take the high temperature limit, you can write it as, you can take the high temperature limit and then put it in the exponent. So, but I'm not going to do that. Okay. I'm literally going to write the Bose distribution. So if you had set up the whole problem in fermions, then this would have become whatever n bar f, which will be nothing but e to the beta omega plus one. Okay, then it become Fermi distribution. Okay, so there is no high temperature limit or low temperature limit, nothing. This is for any temperature. Okay. So next question, could you say what governs TS again? Okay, so TS, what finally governs TS is essentially. Like imagine you have a harmonic oscillator coupled to a bath and I study some initial value problem. Okay. What governs TS is going to be how this harmonic oscillator gets decayed to the environment. When we compute explicitly the quantities, then you will see exactly what governs. Okay. So for example, let me do this. I'll anyway do this hopefully by the end of this class. I will literally calculate what is A dagger A as a function of t. Okay, I literally calculate this for some initial value problem. Okay, and let me say that I have a cavity and I start from vacuum. Okay, so A dagger A is zero and I couple it to a bath. Then A dagger A in at some steady state will take some value. Now we'll see what governs that dynamics. And what governs the dynamics in that case is actually going to be system bath coupling information, okay, and so on and so forth. So this is quite easy to see once you solve the equation. But it's very important to note that if you just see this equation, okay, maybe this is also if you just see this equation, it is not that easy to see what is going on. We have to continue doing some things and then we can see what governs the time scale of the system. But I will explicitly give you expressions of what governs the time scale of the system in this case. Okay, we will see. We will make some plots and so on. Okay, so I hope. Okay, so I hope this is clear. So naively speaking, what governs the dynamics of the system is things like cavity dissipation or qubit dissipation. Okay, this is what decides how the system relaxes to some steady state and so on. Okay, but precisely where it enters and how it enters, we will discuss. Okay. Okay. So now let me just proceed to. Okay, so I have this expression, equation 13 and 14. So here again I have written in words, but there's an integral t here. Okay, there's an integral t at the top. But since t, note that t is of the order of ts and tau integration anyway was dominant for much shorter times, right? This tau integration we know was dominant for much shorter times. So you might as well take this t to infinity here. Okay. So this is just a further simplification where I can replace this upper part by infinity because there is no harm in doing so. Okay. And then if you do that, then you can recast. So once you have infinity here, then you see, then alpha, beta now become independent of time completely. Okay. And now you get a very sort of elegant looking equation. Okay. Okay. So I hope it is clear, right? So what it's saying is that anyway, I know that tau integration beyond a point doesn't matter because of bath correlation functions. So whether I do tau is 0 to t or 0 to 2t or 0 to infinity, it doesn't matter. But it's useful to put this infinity because once I do this, I can explicitly write down some answers here. Okay. Okay. So I hope the logic is clear that you do Born Markov approximation, rho tilde only becomes a function of t now, no more tau. And then you simplify things further as much as possible. And what you will get is finally you will get something like equation 15. Okay. And in the end, you go back to the Schrödinger picture. Okay. And then you will actually get equation 15. Okay. You'll get equation 15. Okay. So I hope these are all slightly lengthy derivations, but it's reasonably straightforward. Okay. So please try to repeat the derivations. So finally, what do we have? So finally, we have rho dot, which is going to be my system of interest. Okay. And we have, so that is basically written like this, times plus this plus this. Okay. So now let us analyze these quantities one by one. Okay. So this quantity is basically, you can call it Hermitian part. Okay. It's basically Hermitian part. Okay. This omega C becomes omega C prime because there is a small correction because of the path, but let's come back to that later. But this is essentially Hermitian part. This one essentially is going to be the non-Hermitian part. Okay. And this operator here, this notation is called the Lindblad super operator. Okay. The notation is the following. This is the notation. Okay. So let me add a page and just say what, how, so Lindblad of A, okay. Lindblad of A rho is going to be A rho A dagger minus half A dagger A rho plus rho A dagger A. Okay. Okay. So let me simplify it further. Let's say that temperature is going to zero. If temperature is going to zero, I can forget this piece. Okay. Because N bar, you will see that N bar goes to zero then. Then this basically simplifies to be rho dot equal to minus I omega C prime A dagger A rho minus rho A dagger A plus gamma N bar is zero times A rho A dagger minus half A dagger A rho plus rho A dagger A. Okay. So now gamma and omega C prime, gamma and all are defined later, but the important point to remember is that we have made dramatic simplification of the system. Okay. So this is the important piece here. So gamma and omega C prime is nothing but the bare cavity frequency with some corrections. Okay. This is omega C prime has omega C plus some corrections, and gamma is basically some quantity. Okay. Some constant. Okay. And N bar is nothing but the value of the Bose function at omega C and temperature T. Okay, so everything is completely well defined here, and basically you have this reduced density matrix of the quantum harmonic oscillator. Okay, so I hope it's clear what you don't need to worry about the symbols. If it is makes you confused, you can explicitly write down this. So this is the answer at temperature going to zero. Okay.
Manas.
Yes.
At zero temperature, can you give a physical intuition of what does dissipation mean here, the non-Hermitian part?
No, no. So the thing is, you know, at the temperature still can go to zero, but still, the cavity which is coupled to the environment can just give away bosons to the environment and become vacuum, right? So you can still have close to zero temperature, and you basically can still have a very dissipative environment, right? Right.
Manus.
Yeah.
Didn't in the previous approximation, didn't you assume that actually temperature is large?
No. So
you had this time scale, right?
Right. So okay. I should be very, very careful here. This I wrote here just to show you, just to elaborate on this Lindblad equation. Okay. Strictly speaking, I should have written this piece also. Okay. Mm-hmm. But what I mean is that I should have written gamma n bar Lindblad of a dagger rho. I should have written this, but the important point is the temperature can be small such that n bar is still very small, okay? But it can still be large enough for Markovian approximation to be valid, okay? There, it could happen that the temperature can be small for the value of n bar itself to be small, okay? But the Markovian approximation could still be valid. So that is that can happen, okay? So that's fine, that's still fine. But
when you say small, you are basically comparing with H cross, right? I mean, in some limit, no?
So okay. So
in some units.
Right. So what do I mean by n bar omega cavity is nothing but e to the power beta omega minus one, right?
Yes.
Right. So here, basically, I'm just asking when is this? So I just want the temperature such that this is small. This whole quantity is small. Okay. But still the temperature could be larger than the system time scales. It's possible.
Okay.
Right. It's possible. Okay. I mean, I'm just saying that it's not guaranteed, but I can still work if you give me omega cavity of something, some gigahertz. Okay.
I can
find some temperature where this value is small, but still, that is the thing.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay, but that's a very important point. I mean, the point is one should be careful because in strict zero, as you keep approaching zero, you might sacrifice Markovian approximation. You might start, violating that requirement. But sometimes these things work, better than they are expected to sometimes. But okay, I'll come back to that later. But yeah, so that is the thing. So okay. So now let's see. Okay, so you have this kind of expression. Okay. So here the most important thing is now what to do with it, right? I mean, this is still a bit good looking. It looks fine, but the question is you still have to compute some quantities, right? So now if I go back to my harmonic oscillator and actually compute, so I ask
So this equation of the previous stage. So this basically gives you the effective evolution of the density matrix of the oscillator.
Anupam, can you speak a bit loudly? Your volume is very low.
So reduced density matrix of the oscillator. Right. So this evolution, has it been shown that this actually takes the oscillator to the equilibrium state with the temperature of the bath?
I'm absolutely going to show that. Yeah. In fact, this is what I'm going to show.
Another question. So it looks like that this equation is similar to kind of a Fokker-Planck equation for the oscillator, where this is the unitary part of the evolution, and then we have the dissipative part and those things.
Right.
So in the Fokker-Planck equation, you also have this, and then there you can identify some fluctuation dissipation terms.
Right.
So here also you have such identifications.
So this thing I have to think about actually. So this I will have to think about how to I think at least for a single oscillator coupled to a bath, you should be able to show explicitly that you have fluctuation dissipation theorem. Is that your question?
Yes. It
should
also be there in the equation.
Right.
It is already there in the
So this is the thing. I think you see, this is the equation is basically this, right? What I wrote. And gamma and okay, so let me just say that the gamma and omega c prime, everything is given here in equation 17 and 18. But where that is hidden, that information is hidden, yeah, I have to think about that. Yeah.
When you write like the equation you have written below, where you just look at the diagonal, afterwards you are going to. So there, if you basically look at the transition rates, I guess they in some sense satisfy detail balance, right?
Yes. No, that is true. In fact, literally, I wanted to go to that, but I actually calculated this further, but I did not put it in the notes. But yeah. But at the level of just the Lindblad master equation, it's hard to see.
Can I add some point addressing Anupam's question? So it turns out that typical Lindblad equations, if we compute some response and correlation functions, they don't satisfy fluctuation dissipation theorems typically. Only they satisfy in the weak coupling, strictly weak coupling zero limit, like gamma, you literally have to take it to zero. It can be verified for the harmonic oscillator in contact with bath at finite temperature. You find that your response function is some sort of a Lorentzian, but your Keldysh functions are going to be, or correlation functions are going to be proportional to the Bose functions evaluated at the cavity frequency. So literally they don't satisfy the fluctuation dissipation theorem. You have to take gamma going to zero to show that. But detail balance is certainly satisfied by.
Right. So at least, I have to think about
detail balance is satisfied, then it's okay.
It satisfies. In fact, density matrix at long times becomes same as the equilibrium density matrix. Yes.
Yeah. So I think I'm coming to all those things actually. So yeah. Indeed, this was my purpose to say that once you have rho, okay. Forget all this low temperature limit and all. Let's go back to the original equations. Okay. This thing here. So now once I know rho dot, I am now ready to calculate something like n rho n equations for these kind of quantities, right? So this is what I'm going to achieve here. So I'll call Pn as n rho n, okay, this is referred to as Lindblad master equation, okay, master equation, okay. So if you do that, then you basically have, you can write equations for Pn dot, okay? So this is basically equation for probabilities, okay? And here you can make some nice diagram and see which term is doing what here. And as a result of this, you will see the detail balance is satisfied. Maybe in the next class, what I will do is I will maybe, write some additional steps here. And elaborate this a bit more, but basically once you have this Lindblad master equation, you can get equations for probabilities, rate equations for probabilities. Okay, so now let me actually go to something like expectation values, where we will again address this question that has been coming up. So what if we want to just calculate A dot? Okay. What if you just want to calculate A dot, right? So if you want to calculate A dot, what you are going to do is you have to basically do trace of A rho dot. Okay. Trace of A rho dot. And then what is rho dot, right? Then rho dot is essentially, you just substitute this equation. Okay. So please do this exercise. It is easy, but it requires a little bit of using cyclic properties and so on and so forth. So it's something that you need to practice. So, but let me just give you let me just calculate A dot. Okay. So let me just calculate A dot. Okay. So basically A dot is equal to trace of A rho dot. Okay. Okay, and this is going to be basically minus I omega naught omega cavity prime trace of a dagger a rho minus a rho a dagger a plus gamma by 2. Okay, I'm just filling up some intermediate calculations here, but I just want to highlight that the way it needs to be done. Okay. Okay, so if you actually explicitly calculate, I have just put back the Lindblad master equation in this quantity, but the important point is that if you explicitly calculate, you can show that this is nothing but minus gamma by 2 plus I omega naught prime trace of a rho again, okay, which is nothing but minus gamma by 2 plus I omega naught prime expectation value of a. Okay, so this is you have to use a lot of commutation relations and cyclic properties of trace, but finally you should be able to write equations of motion for a dot. Okay, so once you do that, then you can literally calculate the solution a of t. Okay, you can calculate solution a of t and basically this is the solution. Okay. Now, more interesting question, of course, very interesting question is what is n dot? What is the equation motion for n dot? Okay. So for n dot, the equation of motion is actually turns out to be this. Okay. So this is it's a reasonably lengthy calculation again, because it involves a lot of commutation relations and tracing cyclic properties, but you can show that the equation of motion for n dot is actually this. Okay, and the solution for n is given by this equation. Okay, I'm sorry, I'm going a little bit faster because I'm running out of time, but the solution of n is this. Okay, so now we go back to the questions that were asked. So this is basically the solution of n as calculated from Lindblad master equation. So what is n bar? So let's not forget what n bar is. N bar is e to the power beta omega cavity minus 1. Okay, I'm forgetting h bar and kb here. This is the value of n bar. Okay. So what is beta? Beta was the inverse temperature of the bath. Okay. So now let me just make a plot. Let me make a plot of n of t expectation value versus time. Okay. So here you can see when you plot 24, when you plot equation 24, let us say you start from vacuum. Okay, let us say that you start with some empty cavity. Okay, so it starts from zero. Okay, and at zero time it is say zero, because n of zero is zero, and then at some steady state it reaches a value n bar. Okay, it reaches a value n bar. So which basically means that the thermal fluctuations, the thermal noise is fed into the oscillator from the reservoir. So you could start from vacuum, but it takes the value of n bar at T. Okay, it takes the value of n bar evaluated at the reservoir temperature. Similarly, you can start from some other n bar, and then it'll again go back here. Okay, so now you see it also answers this question of how this system is relaxing to the steady state. Okay, and there you see that it relaxes and gamma is playing a role. Okay, so now you have to make sure that this gamma rate gamma is respecting Markov approximation. Okay, so the important point is that the mean energy does not decay to zero. The mean energy does not decay to zero. In fact, in the steady state, the mean energy becomes that for a quantum harmonic oscillator with frequency omega c. Okay, the oscillator acquires the environment temperature, basically. Okay, so coupling a system to this environment at some given temperature and just waiting for the system to reach a steady state is basically you end up with the oscillator at that temperature. Okay, so I'm not sure. So maybe I went too fast, but I will probably just recap this in the next lecture once. But I hope the questions in the process were also answered that were asked. So I have some other things here, but maybe I'll stop here and take questions because I just want to say one point. So what do we finally get out of master equation? Finally, we get that n bar of t. Sorry, finally we get n of t in the steady state. Okay, is equal to 1 over e to the beta omega cavity minus 1. This is the result from Lindblad master equation. Now the question is this going to be true from quantum Langevin equation, or is it going to be true from some other non-perturbative methods? Okay, if I do a non-perturbative thing, is this statement going to be true? Okay, so that is those are the kind of things we'll answer in the next class. But I hope but I just want to say that the bath is acting like a thermal drive, right? Even if I don't have any bosons in the system, even if my occupation is zero to begin with, I acquire population from the bath. Or reverse is true. I may start with a lot of population, but then I can just give it away to the bath. Okay. So in next class I will clarify a bit more about this I just wanted to show for schematic purposes, but maybe I'll say a few things more about this populations. But I'll stop here.
Okay, Manas.
Yeah.
Yeah. So this poverty that so P and the equation you wrote down the coefficient thing. So this is looks like the classical master equation also, right? So is it true only in under this Born this Markov approximation, or in general you get this
right? So in this particular setup, when you write equations for basically this is equation for diagonal elements of the density matrix, right?
Yeah. Yes.
So it turns out that in this system, somehow they are not coupling to the off diagonal elements. Okay. Mm-hmm. So that is why you end up getting some rate equation. But yeah. Very quickly, you can imagine a situation where diagonal elements of density matrix start coupling to off diagonal elements. So this is actually. In very simple cases, you can get some actual rate equation.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So is it
the reason why this, like, it will give correct population at low temperatures as well, where basically, so it will give spontaneous emission, okay, like every like ground state is fully occupied, that, like it will correctly predict that. So even if the Born Markov approximation is not valid, this will give you the correct answer. Is it because of the thing that you just justified, the populations are not coupling?
I would be a bit more careful. I don't want to necessarily conclude or connect the two, but I think it just turns out that it's the diagonal elements here are like. Yeah, effective rate equations. I don't want to conclude anything, because you could have situations where you could have more complicated population equations, but still it could give the right steady state, in the weak system coupling. So I think it depends on the system, and it's a bit risky to connect it.
The evolution of the off diagonal element for this problem.
Anupam, what's your question? Evolution of
off diagonal element.
Evolution of off diagonal element. I guess if you actually do something like n rho m, okay. Let's call it rho n m. I think what happens is that eventually, no matter what you start with, eventually I think these off diagonal elements die out. Okay, for this system, I have to explicitly calculate it, but I think you could start with some very complicated initial density matrix and do the evolution. I think the off diagonal elements should die out.
They should. The question, my question is how exponentially they will die out. Or?
I think they will die out. They will die out exponentially. If they die out, they are going to die out exponentially. So one thing that comes out of Born Markov approximation is most of the decays basically start having exponentials because it's Markovian, and because of these rates, you get exponential decays. Yeah, yeah.
And further away N and M are like, they decay faster. Further away N and M, they decay faster. So coherences between states which are further like decay faster, right? In this setup.
Right. I mean, so yeah, explicitly we have to
large energy differences.
Right. Yeah. Presumably. Yeah. Presumably we have to work it out. But so one thing I just wanted to say, since it came up, so notice that this density matrix, strictly speaking, is infinity by infinity, right? Because this is bosonic system. But one good way of doing these problems is to assume something called N cutoff, okay, and actually study some large density matrices. So this is not like a two-level system where you have a 2x2 density matrix, okay, but you can assume some large N cutoff and calculate some evolutions of some big density matrices, and you will see that if you are at in some reasonable parameter regimes, if you keep increasing this N cutoff, it doesn't change anything. So you can truncate this matrices. Okay, so that is just a comment which will be useful for tutorial number second tutorial on Thursday. So, but yeah.
Hi, Manas.
Hi.
So, Manas, I have a question that so you started with this harmonic oscillator problem, and then you ended up in the Lindblad master equation type. So, right. Is it always true that means for any sort of setup, we can transform that problem into Lindblad master equation type, or are there some sort of conditions or involved to convert the problem into a Lindblad master equation?
Right. So no, it is not true. Actually, even now, this is like a sort of active area of research. So even if you have, think of two harmonic oscillators, right? Let me just have two harmonic oscillators and couple them to Bath. Okay, Bath 1, this is harmonic oscillator 1, and Bath 2, and this is harmonic oscillator 2. Okay, this is just two harmonic oscillator, A1 dagger A1 and A2 dagger A2. And let me have a coupling between them called G A1 dagger A2 plus Hermitian conjugate. Okay, and this first harmonic oscillator coupled to its Bath, second harmonic oscillator is coupled to its Bath. Even here, if you can go until this Born-Markov approximation, but from there onwards, you cannot always write it as Lindblad of A1 plus Lindblad of A2.
Okay.
So in principle, you cannot really write, you have to, in very specific limits, you can write it as effective Lindblad equations.
Manas, I have another doubt. So in the trigamma function that we got,
right.
So it's actually a complex function, not a real function.
That's right.
So the real part and complex part both have the same time scale, or the characteristic time scale TR that we got. So
yeah.
So is it only the property of real?
That's a very good point. So actually notice that these guys here. These have a real and imaginary part, and in this case the time scale is actually TR, but the details of the real versus imaginary piece, the details are different, okay, but the time scale is still TR in this particular case, okay, but notice that always there is a real and imaginary, in most cases there is a real and imaginary piece, so you have to just make sure that both are in good enough shape to be able to do Markov. Okay, so that is one comment. But in this case, indeed, TR is what guides the decay, but the decay forms are different, okay, slightly different. Okay?
So it's probably the tail is what, 1 by 1 plus I T by TR whole square or something like that.
That's right. And I just want to say that, okay, this trigamma function was just an example, but
yeah,
I would say that, by and large, you have to just assume some J omega with some cutoff, and that should be just to get an idea of this time scales. But so that is the thing. Yeah.
I think we should stop here because next lecture will start soon. So I guess any more questions? I guess you have that tutorial today also, right?
Technically we can just be available, but
or before the next class, I guess we can discuss.
Right.
So I guess we'll stop here, and we'll start the next session soon.
Okay. So there was one more question that I will probably just
answer. Okay. Yeah, please go ahead.
I'll answer it separately. Okay, so what is the, so if the resolver such that HS are commutes with HS, one would expect the system to evolve unity. In that situation, does the visibility occur? Let me just try to I'll note down this question and maybe I'll just I'll just discuss this question maybe later. Is Saurav there? If he's there, we can just communicate later. Is that because
Okay, then Manas tomorrow.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay.
See, bye.